Good afternoon. Shall we discuss distributed system? It's one of the important subject and interesting subject you can easily learn because you are all using the latest applications, LinkedIn and Facebook, WhatsApp, like this. There are many distributed applications you are using. So that's why this subject is most important to learn how this distributed applications are working. Because you already studied some of the traditional subject like networking, network concepts, network layers, and all you studied already. And why you have to study this distributed application? Because we are all using the latest applications. The application which is working on the top of the networks. So that is why this distributed system is very important. You have to study. Now, I'll share that notes. So I prepared for the first unit. Notes are available. I'll share that. Then again, we'll talk about this, the distributed systems advantage. Also, why we have to study this subject and what are the units are available in this subjects. We have to study and then we have to understand, you know, because we are using the real life. The most of the application we are using, Skype we are using. There are so many video conferencing we are doing. But we don't know how these systems are working, how these applications are working, what algorithms are used inside, what is heterogeneous systems, and then you have to study the peer-to-peer systems, and then already you know that, you know, client-server architecture and all, you know already. So now you have to study how these systems are working, and first unit is about the introduction one, introduction part one. So you can see that. First unit. So what is available in the first unit? Hello, listening to me? Right. So CS8603 distributed system. In this first unit, we are going to study definition, relation to the computer system components, motivations, relation to the parallel system, message passing system versus shared memory systems, primitives for the distributed communication, synchronization versus asynchronous execution, design issues, challenges, the model of distributed computations, a distributed parallel program, the model of distributed execution, model of communication networks, global state, cuts, past and future concept on events, models of process communication, logical time, in which we have to study a framework for a system of logical clocks, scalar time, vector time, physical clock synchronization. That's finally you have to study NTP. So somewhat the vast syllabus only, but we can divide into topics, I mean chapters. You can easily, you know, divide into chapters and you can easily study this particular syllabus. The 2017 regulation syllabus somewhat vast than previous syllabus first units very less only, only 8 hours only, but this year they given more topics, but you can easily study. Only thing is you have to understand the concepts. That is more than enough. So because how these systems are working and what is the concept involved in the particular distributed applications, if you understand, then everything when you read out this particular theory, you can easily understand. I'm telling here how this unit we can study easily. The first thing we have to study about the individual systems. So relation to the computer system components and relation to the parallel systems. So up to this level, we can study easily. So definition, relation to the computer systems, the components, whatever, you know, you are studying about the computers, you can study here. Components, motivation, why we have to do this into a distributed system. And there are some characteristics are there that we can study. And then relation to the parallel system, this and all we can study. After this, the message passing system is very important. And versus shared memory system. See here, there are two things are there. One is distributed memory system and shared memory system. These two architecture you have to study. This topic is very important in the particular unit. Distributed memory and shared memory concept you have to study, and then model of distributed computations. Then under this, there are many topics are available, you can see. Right? So model of distributed communication. Before that, in this part, sometimes they can ask the basic question about like this. Otherwise, they can straight away ask the questions. Shared memory architecture, distributed architecture, and then interconnection networks. The mega networks, switch networks, Omega networks, like this. There are some switches concept like this used inside that can be asked in this first topics. And then design and design issues and challenges. This is also possible. And here mainly we are discussing about the synchronous versus asynchronous. The total distributed communication is coming under synchronous and asynchronous, blocking and non-blocking mechanism. That you also have to study. And finally, this part. These are simple questions only. Global state and then cost. This is not even. They happen before events and then cascading. No? The casual events and all you can study here. Logical time, after that logical time you can study. Finally, NTP. So like this you can study. Mainly this particular unit, what will be the important questions? The first part, shared memory, distributed memory. And design issues, some challenges are there that you can study. And model of distributed communication. Finally, logical networks. The model, this process communication, logical networks. That is about these events, related to events. So that will be go through, then whatever question asked, you can easily give an answer. So this is about the first unit. First unit, only theory, only to understand the fundamentals of and basics of the distributed systems. Now let us start the first topic, distributed system. The distributed system, you know already definition, already studied also. So distributed system is a collection of independent entities, heterogeneous systems, collection of system, group of systems connected together to solve the problems. Like this, you can say. Here also given the definition, a distributed system is the one in which hardware or software components are located at network computers, communicate and coordinate their actions only by passing messages, each having its own memory and operating system. This particular definition, the particular paragraph, you can easily understand the entire syllabus. A distributed system means it is connecting the distributed systems, the remotely available systems, everything will be connected together. And then some events will happen by how will this event or task will be happen between two systems by executing the task, right? 1 minute, someone joined now. I just not done. My screen is visible, no? Someone can answer me? Hello, listening, no? Listening. Whatever screen I shared, it is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I hope everybody is listening instead of sleeping, you know. Just go through that what I'm talking here. I'll share this notes and then the questions also. And what are the questions asked from the test groups? End of the every unit, they give the questions. So that questions with the answer also available. That also I'll share you in the end of the class. Okay. So now I told you this distributed system. You can keep easily remember that. For example, LinkedIn system you can take. You are universal mobile also you have a LinkedIn applications, and now you know remotely another person also having the LinkedIn application. You are also accessing and posting your own things on this LinkedIn. Also, your friend also doing like this. For example, Facebook also you can take it. So everybody is having their own mobiles. So it is systems are distributed. It is a heterogeneous systems, not a homogeneous system. It's heterogeneous in the sense different system is having different configurations. So everybody having their own systems, but all systems are connected. How it is connected? By passing the messages. Anything you take it, any applications, what is happening inside actually? Actually, just pass the message. One application to another application, we are passing the messages. Even internally, when you go studying about the process also, what is happening, the process to process communication, just pass the messages. Even object-oriented communication, you take it, they are also just passing the messages. So the distributed system, why it is created, to passing the message from one place to another place. Some events are happening by passing the message. That is a definition of the distributed system. You can instead of mucking this all the concepts, you can practically just understand. So distributed, this is the application. Skype is one of the application. Now we are using Google Meet. This is one of the distributed applications. How these applications are working? It's all connected. Two systems are connected by hardware and software, right? What is happening between two systems? Just passing the message. Now my voice is coming as a message to you. Also my content, this content also coming to you as a message, right? So these are all now happening because of this distributed systems only. How this system is happening? It is happening in this distributed system. There are two concepts are very important in the distributed concepts. You can categorize in the entire distributed system in two areas. One is the client server architecture. It's an olden concepts. Nowadays we are talking about peer-to-peer systems. The peer-to-peer system, PER to PER. So that is peer-to-peer systems. The peer-to-peer system is the latest in network communications. So what is happening with the client server architecture? Already you know that there is a server is there. Under this server, all the clients are connected. So one client want to communicate with another client, means it has to send the request to the server. Through server, it will reach the particular clients. Then it will pass the messages. It is happening. How it is identified in the networks, where the system is located, we will have two addresses. One is IP address, another one is physical address. So physical address is a machine address, which is a permanent one. This IP address you can change anytime. It's a dynamic address. So it is like this, there are two addresses. So anywhere, even if system is available in US, some system is available, because you take Google server, it's available somewhere in some other country. So even server, Yahoo, Gmail server is available in US. So you can, if you want to send the message, you just by using the URL only, you are sending the message. In turn, the URL is having the IP address. It's the IP address, the identification, where the particular system, the address is, you have to know the address, where the system is, and where the data center is available. So immediately we are sending our messages going to there only, then it is processed in their environment, then it is coming back the result. It is a common procedure. Even clients of architecture, it started like this only. So server is a controller. Server is going to control all the systems. So we'll create a domain. Domain is, so it's about the information about the client systems. It is available in the domain. Server will understand what are the clients are available through domain. So through domain, it will communicate with all the systems. So if you understand this concept easily, then it is very easy to understand this subject. That's why I'm telling this. So everybody should understand. Instead of all those things by mapping this, while going through this every paragraph, you have to understand. So this is a concept like this. So there is a server. Under this server, all the systems are connected. So it's a client-server communication. Server is how the server will access each and every system by using the IP address and then physical address, that is machine address. So this is a communication. Next, about the here about the previous one, you can understand there is a master slave concept. So server is a master. Another one is a slave is a client. Why? How we can divide like this? Master means it is able to service a request. So which system is able to service the client request? That system is called server. For example, in our college also we have a server. The server is available in other locations. We have a clients in our labs. So the system, whatever you are working, that you are sending to the server only. You have your own space is having in your server. You are going to your logins only. Your name and your CS1004 something ID. Using the ID, you are accessing your server. You are accessing and saving your data, everything in the server space only. But there is a communication happening between two systems. So server, whose server means who's going to service the request of the client. Who is the client? Client is request means it is generating the request. It is generating the request or sending the request to the server. That is client. But this is a concept. This is called master-slave concepts. Master-slave concept. So when you understand these things, all the topics are covered in this whatever concept I'm telling you. So next thing you have to understand now. So what is the next latest one? That is peer-to-peer communication. Here, there is no master-slave concepts. Everybody is act as a server, everybody is act as a client. How we can do this classification? The person who wants to send a message, who wants to send a request, that is, he is act as a client now. The same person, after some time, is going to a service, going to resolve some problem or going to service the request from somebody else. That time, that same client is called as a server. But what we can understand now, the system, same your mobile, it's itself, it's one of the peer system. So this your mobile will sometime will send the request to somebody else, and same time some request is coming also to your mobile. Your mobile will service that also, right? So that is why the system is able to service and send the request. So both are done in the same system itself. That is why it's a peer-to-peer systems. So whatever the latest application about LinkedIn and then whatever your Twitter, whatever applications, the distributed applications, everything working under the peer-to-peer communications. So peer-to-peer communication means that is no client-server concepts here, no master-slave concepts here. Everybody is a server, everybody is a client. How we can divide, differentiate this, who is server, who is client? So someone who is servicing the request, somebody sent the request, that will be serviced by the server means that is that time that person is called a server. Sometime when he is sending the request, that is called it's a client. So that is what the concept in the distributed system. You have to understand the distributed system. This is about the peer-to-peer communication. So you are starting from second unit and third unit and all, it is about peer-to-peer system. First unit only the basic fundamental, how it is communicating each other, what are the entities you have to study, that you have to understand. But the concept is like this only, communication, passing the message from one place to another place. So one application, for example, when you want to start some web applications, for example, Flipkart one, when you open the Flipkart and start to add the items in your cart, so what happened? There are so many messages are created. That is, each one is a event. Each one is a event. There is every event is having the timestamp. So E1 of T. So like this, there are so many events are created behind of background in the application itself. All this because millions or trillions of applications are created and events are created. How it's happening in the world? Because now you can understand the COVID situation. You can understand everything depends on the internet only. All those things happening in the distributed applications only. Whatever you take it in a system, everything is working. You are sharing, you are giving some information to somebody else. And it's all coming around the world. Why? Because of this distributed system. So understand why, what I'm telling here. So everything is a event. So message, everything created as a message. The message is going from one place to another place. So what we are going to study in this subject, we'll study what is the components of the computers, and what is heterogeneous and what is processor, what is parallel processing and parallel systems. And then we have to study this distributed memory, shared memory means what? Memory and processor, how connected each other and how processor and memory is connected. What are the switching networks are used inside? That is called interconnection networks, omega networks. And then this kind of mesh networks, how it is used inside the, how this processor and the coupled means, coupled each other. And processor and memory, that's in general you can study. After studying this one, then you have to study about the events, how message processing is happened before, and then casual events, everything, how happening this and that, you will study in the first unit. You got an idea? So this is about the first unit. Whatever I told you now, if you understand this, then you can easily, when you go through this first unit, 36 pages only is there, the first unit, when you go through this particular concepts, everything, every topics, below the subtopics are there. When you understand the topics, then it is very easy, right? So now we will go through one by one now. I think you got an idea now what is about a distributed system and here what is distributed system. If you are not able to remember that whatever the paragraph is given, just understand it's a group of heterogeneous system or independent system, right? Grouped together to pass the or to communicate to each other by passing the message. Your own sentence you can write. It is not a problem. And second thing, second point, you see, characteristics of the distributed system. It's a So autonomous called settings, security settings are, you have a mobile means you have your own privacy, right? So there are so many different processors available, all communicating over the communication networks. So what, while communicating each other, what are the points you have to remember? No common physical plan. So I have a mobile, I have a time, maybe 5 minutes fast or 10 minutes slow. somebody is having US, I want to communicate my friend in US, I want to teach him some technical concepts, then when he connect with me, he is having its own time in his system. How it is managed, how it is coordinated each other. That coordination, that also you will study here. Communication, the clocks, how coordination is happening. Hey, logical clocks, Lambert logic. So there are everything depends on the time. Because the event, there are two events are there, means one event is less time, another event is more time, means the timestamp. Maybe one is less, one is more. But which event will happen first? The event which is less time. So that is why it happened before. So A, T of A is happened first and D of P is happening second. Means D of A less than D of B. Might be studied, you know, already in this this concept problem studied. So like that is why here no common physical clock, right? And then no shared memory. So this is a characteristic of the distributed system. Hence it is required message passing for communication and implies the absence of common physical clock. So no shared memory. So before that, I want to tell you about this, you know, distributed memory and then shared memory. So shared memory, you know, how would be the architecture of shared memory? There is a single memory is connected with more than one processor. Or more than one processor sharing a single memory. That is a shared memory concept. Distributed memory means each processor is having its own memory, independent memory. So that is a distributed memory. But here what the concept they are saying, no shared memory. So somebody is now distributed system which support this shared distributed memory. So I have my own system, I have a memory. Somebody is having the system, they are having their own memory. So that is a concept. There is no characteristic one of this, no shared memory. Distributed system provide the abstraction of common address space via distributed shared memory abstraction. So the points what I told you, just keep remember, distributed memory is having its own memory. And geographical separation, right? You are in India, some systems are available in US and UK. So that is how geographically it is divided. So that is about the, then you can remember that concepts of networks, local area networks, wide area networks, here network of cluster of workstation, NOW and COW, configuration connecting processors on a LAN. So LAN local area networks, here what happened, there are multiple systems are connected together. Every system is having its own processor. So here we are talking about processor only, we are not talking about computer one, computer two. We are going just inside, we are talking about how processor is communicating each other. Our system is my processor is communicating with your processor. That is what the communication networks, right? When we study the subject, you just keep remember about the processor only, not your, to think about your box of computers. So here how the processor is communication, how the processor is communicating each other. When I have a system, internally how processor solving my own problems inside my system. And same system is how responding to the outside when the request is coming to my system. So it's a distributed system. You can understand, when you create the space in the lane, you have admitted some of the friends are there inside and whatever postings are there, you can see. And you can also post something that will be displayed in somebody else's space. But you cannot make a constraint or conditions to somebody else's space. But you can create your own setting, security setting for your own page in a linked layer. So like this, so that is a segregated like this one. So that is about the geographical separations. Now configuration, the low cost, high speed of the cell process, right? For example, pool search engine. Autonomy and heterogeneity. Heterogeneity means different systems. Different system is having different configuration. Autonomy means that is having its own controls. Autonomous like this. The processor is loosely coupled. Coupled means connectivity, connection, memory and processor, how it's connected to each other. So that is about the loosely coupled, having different speed and each run in a different operating system, but cooperate with one another by offering the services for solving a problem jointly. The processor loosely coupled and tightly coupled also there. So processor are, because here you know the basic concept, like single processor is there, now parallel processor is there. I3 processor is a parallel processor. I5 processor is a parallel processor. I7 is a parallel processor. Parallel processor is means what? More than one processor is going to solve your problems. So the work is distributed among the three processors. So what is the advantage here? The work is done parallelly. The execution is done parallelly. So that is why here we are talking about how processors coupled with each other. Loosely coupled means having different speed. And each run different operating system, but cooperate and with one another by offering services for solving the problems jointly. So that is about the autonomy and heterogeneity. So this is about the characteristics of the distribution. So sometimes it will be a two-mark question. No physical networks, no memory, sad memory, geographical person. Generally, you can understand. Because already this subject you listened, already you have learned the subject. Now we are going for revision only. So you can go quickly. Some of the concept you know already. So just I am going through quickly, you can understand, right? Relation to the computer system components, right? Distributed system, you can see as a memory processing unit are connected by a communication networks. That's what I told you initially. There is a processor, there is a memory. It's a major part. It's these two only communicating each other. These two only coupled to each other. Because you do some processing, after processing you save the data in the memory. Or if you want to do something, that data will be coming from the memory one. So major communication happening within a system, it is about the processor and memory. Or the same thing you want to happen, it should be happen in some other system means, you have to take the data from one system to another system. There is a memory and processor is available. The data will be kept temporarily in the main memory, then it will be processed by the processor. When the result comes, that is coming back to the memory, then the same data is going to, the result where should go, that place the system is sending back to the data. So that is a basic communication here. So that is what the relations, so that is what they are talking about here. So you can look at the diagram, you can easily understand. So everyone is a system, get processor, memory. You can understand. So these are all connected in the networks, communication networks, wide area networks, local area networks. So this is what relation, just a common basic relations between the processor and memory, that is about the computer system, you can write. And usually the system, what happened? So there is a distributed applications. So that application is running on the top of the networks. That is why, you know, we can overlay network, something is studying, overlay networks. Overlay network means some applications running top of the networks, means you have a normal networks only, you have a traditional networks. On this network, what we are installing, you are installing, you know, Zoom, you are installing that Google Meet. So while running this Google Meet, it's a special application that runs on the some of the traditional networks which you are using for regularly for us communicating, sending mail and all this. You are using the some special application on top of the networks. Now that is called distributed systems. There are so many web applications are running on the web, on the internet, right? So that is our distributed system. So how it is processed? Distributed application is running, that is coming. Distributed software, so there are middle layers are available that will communicate with your own hardware using. It's also passing through all the layer, application layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer. This is about the network protocol stack. It's working with your operating system. Finally, the data will be taken from your memory or will be stored in your memory. It is a basic operation in your distributed systems. And another point you have to understand, middleware. The middleware technology is a very important one. The middleware means you have already studied in object-oriented analysis and design. There is a front end is there and then back end is there. In between, there is a layer is called a middle layer. What for this middle layer? Middle layer will increase the speed, the communication between two, front end and back end. What for this middle layer means? The increase in the processing speed. It is also an Oracle under, they are talking about business intelligent. Because you have data in the back end, the server itself, you know, the database itself, data is there. And the front end, there is a queries are generated. Some data I need from this place. I want this 1982 2000. Some this about this amount. This I need about this data like this. When you ask something, it should be processed in the middle layer. The middle layer, what will interact with the back end? The data is required like this. So you know, collect it and keep it in the middle layer. And parallel, it will happen. So meantime, the middle layer communicate with the front end. It displays some data, and some queries are coming. Means it also processes in the middle layer and going to the server. Getting the data like this. So middle layer, nowadays the middle layer is working good properly. For example, CORBA, RPA concept, remote processor interface, CORBA, these are the middle layer concepts. So middle layer is very important. You can see, assume that middle layer does not contain any application layer functions like HTTP, HTTP mail, FTP telnet like this. So it's about the object management group, common object request proper architecture, CORBA, RPC software, this is the middle layer, right? Just understand what is that, then you can easily understand. And distributed component object layer, DCOM is there, DOM objects are there, the Java, RML, message passing interface. This and all coming under the middle layer technologies, middleware. Middleware means people understand front end, back end. In between there is a layer is called middle layer. There this technology and all working. Why this technology required? The response, quick response. Because when you touch on mobile something, some application, it should respond quickly. When you ask something to the system, it also responds quickly. Then what will happen? You should have middleware. Somewhere somebody should help from the middle. You should ask exactly what is required for a particular user. That is why this middleware technology sometimes is very important, and there is more requirements also in the middleware technologies. Motivation. Distributed system is because of the following requirements. Inherently distributed computations. Inherently means it is must. You cannot remove it. For example, banking application is there. The banking transaction is happening. So the transaction, that task need to be done. Without that, you cannot do. So that is inherently some of the tasks need to be executed in the transaction process. So that is why the distributed system is very important. Application like money transfer in banking requires the computation. That is inherently distributed. Because you have a bank on IOP or some other place, another IOP or some other place, all the IOPs are interconnected. All the IOP networks are connected. Our data center which is available for IOP, data center which is available for SPI. So there are, so every bank is having its own data center. You may have a query like, what is data center? They are having their client data inside once the data center. It's not so like the CPU only, but it's a big size CPU. It is occupied in the entire room. You might be visited a supercomputer in Bangalore, IIC. There also we have seen that the data center. So there is a data center, big size CPUs are available. There are array of hard disks are available. There, what happened? The data are stored. So IOP customers, there are million customers are there. SPI customers are more customers are there. There are all the data are stored in the data centers. Right? But what happens if something bank transaction is happened, means it is through communication networks only. But inherently we require this distributed applications and then resource sharing. So every topic, when you look at the topic, the particular point, you have to understand resource sharing means what. Resource sharing, you have to come understand your computer science term. Resource means memory is a resource, right? And whatever, you know, sharing in between the resources from your system to some other system, there is the data, there is a process migrations, everything is a resource. Peripheral databases, data cannot be fully duplicated all those sites. Duplication also possible because one data is available in server. The same data will not be supplied to more than 1,000 users. That data will be replicated for 1,000 times. Replicated means duplicated. Duplicated for 1,000 times, then it is very easy to serve 1,000 people. So that is a concept happening in the server side concept. So resource sharing is the main important concept because of the distributed application. Access to the geographical remote data and resources. Access to the geographically remote data and resources. Geographically means it may be available in some other locations. Geographic locations, remote data center available. There you will be taking the data. When you read out that only, points will be given. Data may be too large and sensitive, it cannot be replicated. Example, payroll data. Can be stored at a general server like supercomputers, which can be queried using the remote one. So when you read this statement, you have to understand. That's why I'm telling all the basic concepts and whatever concept involved in the subject I'm telling. It is not a tough subject, but easy, but vast syllabus. Means theory is more theories. When you understand, when you see the first topic, means the headings, when you read, see the headings, you have to understand, you can recite the concepts. So how you can recite? Just read out this paragraph. If something is not understand, means you can go through. For example, inherence, word is meaning is I do not understand this inherence. Then go to Google and put it inherence, you can understand the meaning. Something I'm not understanding, it takes particular word. Integrity, you know, because we study in integrity is about in every subject. In database we studied and some other subject I studied. Maximum number of key terms we study every subject. Integrity, there is no change in original data. When I studied also same meaning only. So like this, there are some characteristics are available. If you're not knowing that characteristic, just Google it. So once you Google it and study to two or three lines about that particular word, then you will not forget. While writing the exam, you can easily write. So this time you have to write 3 hours exam. It's open book test only, but you have to know the meaning comes up immediately. So integrity, so where is the topic is available. You have to search it and you have to answer the question. And question not may not be, you know, direct questions. Sometimes indirect questions, you have to think more time and you have to write. I'll show you the last what kind of question will be asked in the data distributed systems. I have a question bank, and it is available in the book also. Glorious book also is available. Then answer reliability. Reliability, we know. Reliability, what is mean reliability? So there is a something happening means it should happen. The communication between, that is a reliability. I'll send some data means it should reach to the it is to the server. That is a reliability. So enhanced reliability, distributed system should be enhanced reliability. The WhatsApp, you are sending some message, it is reached to another person, we can know, because when you open his name and we can see that message is reached, there is a tick marks is coming. That is what the enhanced reliability. So we can understand, previously when you study network layer and TCP layer, when the TCP layer, when the packet sent to from one place to another place, there is acknowledgement packet is coming, so that the message is reached, so it's a reliable communication. Like this, we studied in the traditional networks. Now think about now, what is the latest now? How we are sending the data and how we are thinking whether the communication is established between two persons or not. Everything we can easily understand. That is what enhanced reliability used here. So this understood. So everything you can compare with your practical life, we can easily understand this subject. Availability, resource should be accessible all the time. Your data will be in cloud. You want to access that cloud, somebody is telling that you wait one day. Next day you can access the data, means whether you will be waiting for a particular cloud server to get the data from the server provider. No, that is not a latest technologies. Something is asked in even 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock also, there should be a service. That is a continuous service. Fault, if there is any fault tolerance, if there is any fault, that should be tolerated. There is a fault tolerance, the problem should be rectified by the server. So like this is there. So that is what availability is, okay, the integrity. The data may not be changed, data should not be changed. Even the middle intruder and then somebody will attack, middle attack, man at middle attack, man at middle attack. There should not be any changes in the data. We should have a proper security mechanism, security algorithms, cryptographic algorithms need to be used properly to save data, right? So that is about availability, integrity. And fault tolerance, I told you already, fault tolerance, the ability to recover from the system failure. System itself defends from the problem. Sometimes we have a problem, it will defend. When not a small problem, we can defend. If it is a big problem, we'll go to some other place to report. So like this, fault tolerance is like this. Small issues coming in the server, it should be rectified immediately. So that is about the enhanced reliability. You can go quickly. So we have class up to 4:30. Increased performance, cost ratio, and scalability, right? Increased performance, you can understand. So nowadays we are using the parallel processor. So everywhere you can see the system. Even traffic system also we are using. Game processor also there. There are everything in increased performance, right? Scalability. The meaning of scalability, you have to understand. Scalability means the count number of user at a time. You see the 5 years, 10 years before, how many are using mobile and how many are using the networks, internet. Now look at now this COVID time, everybody is using for communication mobiles only. That is scalability, increased scalability. The number of users are increased. That is a scalability. In distributed applications also like this one, there are number of communication channels are increased and processor count also increased. That is called scalability. However, we should have a proper mechanism to manage everything. So that is about the scalability I told you. And then now modularity, incremental and expandability. So this is about the study, the seventh topic. Modularity, model communication. Heterogeneous process can be easily added without affecting the performance. As processor run the same middleware algorithms, similarly existing process can be easily replaced by other processor. Right? So it's about, I told you already, it's about the communicating processor each other. Processor communication. You have this I3 processor, I5 processor, somebody is having I9 processor, all the processors communicating each other. It's all available somewhere different location. Geographically, it is located in some other locations, but you communicate with each other by using the distributed algorithm, that is middle layer algorithm. There is an algorithm is available. You study in operating system, that means something called a job scheduling algorithm like this. That is internally inside your system by the operating system. But it is also happening middle layer technology, middleware. Your server is somewhere, you have some other place, you are locating some other place, you are sending some request. some algorithm need to be working and getting the data from the server PTA. So that is what we have to understand. So incremental, expandable. So heterogeneous meaning I told you this, different system having different configuration. The next topic quickly we can go. Listen to the parallel multiprocessor, multi-computer systems. So characteristics of the parallel system. Parallel system, when we see the word, you have to understand there is a work and there is a process done parallelly, execution done parallelly. Anything, any task is done parallelly. Multiprocessor environment. The multiprocessor environment also happening like multiple processors working and sharing the task, executing the task. Because maybe for example, you might have studied hybrid threat, HT. And if the processor, when you take the, when you look at the process diagram, there is HT will be the hybrid threading model. But threading means a task is divided into small tasks, small unit of execution. For example, million threads are created means the million threads are divided and supplied to each and every processor. Right, so that processor will execute. That is happening. That is migration, dynamically migrating from one process to another process. One server is busy, is not able to service the request. Automatically, it is redirected or the dynamically moving to another server to service the request. That is what the virtualization concept we will be studying. And then you can understand that how migration happening from the process going to another whatever the process task going to another process job scheduling. So it is not coming under the multiprocessor environment only, because your Yahoo server is, your Gmail server is continuously servicing you 24/7. It's continuously working. How? Because of even one server is handling all the requests more. There are multiple processor, multiple servers are available. One server is not able to service means redirect to the other server. So when you go into the first server, maybe free now. So I automatically come here. Maybe the timing, maybe the delay will be there, but thing is, but you will get the output. So that is what happening in the multiprocessor environment. When you go through this, you can understand. Now, there are two important concepts already told, shared memory architecture and then distributed memory architecture. You can easily understand these two things, UMA, UMA and NUMA. Uniform memory access, non-uniform memory access. These two words, when you keep in mind, you can easily categorize your problems here. Shared memory architecture, it is uniform memory access. And then another point is non-shared memory access, distributed memory architecture. What is the meaning here? Uniform memory access. Uniform memory access means you have a single memory that on this single memory more than one processor is connected. But you have to allow processor one by one to the processor. Then what you have to follow, you cannot see the path you have to over there. You allow P1 system for more time and P2 system less time, like this, you cannot do it. Say anything. That is why uniform memory access you have to follow. So you processor one is first priority, processor one is given request first means first in first out. You just allow the process first and second process. The time order, you will follow some order, right? Casual order you will follow. Time, only the timestamp, you calculate the timestamp, you follow the order. That is uniform memory access. You understand? I think you got to understand uniform memory access. Major categorization, you have to understand that. We'll be studying the next second and third unit under like this only. The concept like this. Distributed memory architecture is a uniform, non-uniform memory access, because every processor is having its own memory. You got idea? Every processor is having its own memory, so that it is very easy to access. And each memory is having private memory and the public. Even every thread is having the private and public thread. Private means its own data. Process data belongs to the own processor, that particular process only. But some data is available, it is for some other processor. This particular processor want to share with the other processor. So that is well there. So that is why the entire thing is talking about the processor and memory. So processor and memory, how it is connected to each other. Well, more than one processor is connected to single memory. Memory means that is a shared memory architecture. You can understand the concept based on the diagram. And here you see this, every processor is having its own memory. Now here you see this, every processor is having its own memory. Here this processor is communicating in another memory. So that is the idea of this. A, see this A, uniform memory access multiprocessor environment. This is the processor memory somewhere is available. Here processor, for four processor, there is a four memories available. Here you see, every processor is having its own memory. Every processor is having its own memory. Yeah. So this what happened? It is between this processor and memory. It is a non-uniform memory access. Anytime you can access and store the data, retrieve the data, whatever happens. So both architectures of the processor may be locally cache data from memory. That's cache memory. So that is what I told you. This private cache, public cache. Here also memory. There are private cache, public cache. Because you cannot say this memory, this processor is not communicating with this processor. Yes, communicating each other. So whatever data can be shared with this processor, that can be shared. That will be available in a public cache. Data may not be shared. That will be in a private cache. That you have to understand. So this is a major divisions in the processor concepts, right? So this is what the communication, the processor memory model. So how it is happening communication? This is now networks switching three stage omega networks. So N8, right? Node 8 and then M message 4. Like this one, communication 4. Now look at this one, how this communication happening. So now this processor is going directly to this memory. Sometimes this processor is going through this and communicating each other. This is called, I told you, the switching networks, right? Interconnection networks. How memory and processor connecting each other. So three stage omega networks and three stage butterfly networks, right? You can see this number of nodes available, how this processor is connecting to this memory, how it is communicating each other, how this processor one is coming from here to here, this memory module. So that is our interconnection networks for shared memory multiprocessor system. Shared memory multiprocessor system, one is omega networks, right? And second one is butterfly networks. These two examples you have to study. So shared memory architecture, you have to study about omega networks and butterfly networks. The diagram you can draw, and then the nodes you can draw each other, and memory also you have to draw from P0 to M07. So this is about memory model, memory plans. This is about the processor. So N processor, 8 processor is there, P0 to P7, memory plans 0 to 7, how it is connected each other. The diagram you can draw, and how communication happening you can execute here. So multi-stage networks, sometimes 2 into 2, and then 8 into 8, like this networks are available. It's nothing but data, how it's routing from one process to memory. So that is what we are studying in the omega networks, right? So omega interconnection function, you can understand. So there is between each pair of adjacent stages, the link exists between output of I of the stage and input J to the next stage, follows the perfect stable pattern. So like this. So if you see that previous one, it is communicating, for example, P of I comma J to M of I comma J. So B of I comma J is a path 0 to 1. Here is a 0 to 1. So how it is link each other, is connecting each other. So that is talking about this particular statements, right? So like this butterfly interconnection functions also like this. How links are connecting each other. So that we can study quickly here. And butterfly routing functions, that also you can go through. Next one is multi-computer parallel system. Multi-computer parallel system. So memory of multiple processor may or may not form a common address space, but do not have a common plan. So as shown in previous one. So it's a multiple memory processor is having its own memory. So that concept you have to study in here. And here what happened, that is non-uniform memory access. That concept you have to keep remember. And here also we have a switching networks, right? You can understand this diagram, processor plus memory. How processor is connected here? See, this and all processor. So it's all connected, so passing the message, communicating each other. And here also you can see. So you see this. So yeah, some popular topologies for multi computer shared memory machines. Yeah, wrap around 2D mesh. This is one, also known as Torus. Hypercube. So this is hypercube. How this processor and message are passing each other. So processor plus memory. So we call it because previous one we studied, that is a shared memory architecture. This is the every processor is having its own memory. That is a processor plus memory. It's a hypercube communications. How the processor itself is a memory, is it? It's communicating each other. So that thing with the diagram you can explain. array processor. Array processor, it belongs to class of parallel computer that physically co-located are very tightly coupled, have a common system clock but may not share memory, communicate by passing the data using messages. Array of processor, array of hard disk, I told you, know, like this, array of processor is available. More than one processor, multi-processor. So it's an array of processor communicating each other. There is no common cache clock, there is no shared memory. Every processor is having its own memory. So the array of processors perform tightly synchronous to each other. Right? So next important topic we study, plane classification. It's a very important question. You can easily remember also. Plane classification is very important one. You can easily remember. So Flynn is another scientist. He created, you know, based on insections, right? Four processing modes based on the whether the processor execute same or different instruction stream. So instruction stream, data stream like this only. It based on this only, nowadays, you know, the multiprocessor and all segregated like this only. Because anything in the computer, it's executed by instruction only. We studied already computer architecture. What is happening inside? Instruction set architecture. More instructions are executed. While executing the instruction, what will happen? The computer architecture itself, you study frame classification. Frame taxonomy, you study already. You can see the processor executes same or different instruction stream, and whether or not process at the same time, data at the same time. So for example, any instruction you want to execute, you need of data. For example, addition of two values, you have to take two values into the register, then you have to keep on empty register, there you have to store the result. But what is the instruction here? Add is the instruction. And what are the data is required here? Two data are available required, and then one register is empty register is required. So that is happening. So that is a concept. That is, he only, the plain only classified into four categories. Single instruction, single data streams. One instruction, one data. So that is, this mode corresponds to the conventional processing in a von Neumann paradigm with a single CPU. Single memory unit is connected. So olden system. In the olden system, you know, one CPU, one single memory. This happened. Desktop system under happening like this one. The next one is single stream data. Single stream, single instruction stream, only one instruction. In which we have multiple data stream. For example, color information. You know, system is having more colors. How it is happening? We are using this SIMD pattern mode. Single instruction, multiple data. In this mode, now processing by multiple homogeneous processor execute in lockstep on different data items. Same instruction only, but different processor is having different data. So applications that involve operations on the large arrays, matrices like scientific application can exploit system with the SMD mode of operations. SMD, you know, even nowadays the gaming processor and all is using this SMD processor. Parallel computers like ELX, 4, MPP, CMP were SMD machines. There are different machines available in the world. It depends on this classification. Single instruction, multiple data streams. Multiple instruction, single data stream. Multiple instruction, all the instruction will use only one data. So that is also happening here. So this is an instruction, right? Single instruction, but multiple data will be processed here. So this is also another idea. Because when you study this one, you have to think about your computer only. How your processor? Your processor is a single instruction, single processor, or multiple instruction, multiple processor like this, you have to categorize. I3 under multiple instruction, multiple data streams. So, yeah, I3 processor under. So, this under, you see, this mode corresponds to your execution of different operations parallel on the same data. This is specialized mode of operation with a limited but niche applications. Visualization. Visualization, you will take multiple data and you have to project it. And multiple instruction, multiple data. Multiple instruction. This mode, various processors execute code on different data. So different processor is having different data. So distributed systems. So multiple processor and multiple instruction, multiple data. For example, Sun Alpha servers, multi-computer PC, IBM SV machines. It allows much flexibility in parsing the code and data to the process among the processor. So plane classification, you can easily understand. Single instruction, single data stream, single instruction, multiple data streams, multiple instruction, single data stream, multiple instruction, multiple data stream. So how the classification, how this client done this classification, client's taxonomy, the classification how you done based on the instruction, stream and data stream. These two we consider and categorized into four types, right? You can keep remember. So apart from this, other than that, you know, other things and all, right, basic what we have to study in this distributed system quickly. I'll tell you the concept and then we can quickly go through this concept, right? So once you understand the concept, you can easily study. So listen to the class. Okay. So next we have to study about the distributed system concept. So for generally how communication networks are working, that is studied. Now we have to study what are the basic things it is used in, say, the distributed systems. Coupling means connecting processor and memory, and parallelism, concurrency, granularity. Parallelism, you know that. Parallelism means what? More than one instructions are executed parallelly. So more than one thread is executed parallelly. So that is of the parallelism. Coupling, already you know that, loosely coupling, tightly coupling. So here you see, and the degree of coupling is high, means the connectivity and sharing of data, that is based on that we are selling. The models are said to be tightly close. Tightly means loosely coupled. And SMD, MMC. So here the coupling means you can understand. Now we are talking about single instruction, multiple data. That how it is equally connected. So that is called coupling. So that is what they are talking about coupling here. So architectures generally tend to be tightly coupled because of the common clocking of shared instruction stream to the shared data streams. So here you have to supply the data to the instruction, that instruction itself, the data need to be executed. That is why the tightly coupled to be executed here. And parallelisms for speed of the program. Parallelism, you can understand. Parallel, you have to execute the instructions. So parallelism is very important. Why we have to go for parallelism? We have to reduce the time. Instead of one by one, all the instructions, we are executing all the instructions, we can execute the instruction parallelly. Instruction level parallelism, threat level parallelism may be studied in the, where you study in the computer architecture itself, advanced computer architecture itself, study. Just keep remember, that's enough. This and all, just read out, we can easily understand. This aggregate measure of percentage of time and all the processor executing CPU instruction productivity. That is all the parallelism. Concurrency in a parallel, both are same meaning only. So parallelism, concurrency in a parallel or distributed program can be measured by the number of local operations to the number of operations, including the communication of a shared memory access operation. Concurrency of the program. How many programs and instructions are executed parallelly? So that is about talking about the distributed application and the number of operations, local operations, there are operations to be performed in the remote location also, how it is done parallelly. So that is about you have to understand. So there are so many, you know, theory. Keep remember what you have to write for this granularity of the program. Granular means you can post fine the grain and coarse grain, like this you study more. Fine grain, coarse grain means switching from one task to another task. The fine grain means one task, it will be, you know, the context switch from one task to another task. It will be done immediately based on the request. The coarse grain means what? Once the process is over, only will go to the next process. The threat, you can, while executing the threat parallelly, that you can understand. Here you see, amount of computation to the amount of communication within the parallel or distributed system term as a granularity. Granularity means the context switch going from one. For example, processor is executing T1 threads and T2 threads. After that only you move to the T3 threads. After switching from one thread to another thread, how it is moving? Whether it is completing the entire work and going to the other thread, or it is only stay on the same thread. That is why it is divided into, one is, you know, fine grain, coarse grain by this one. So that is about the granularity here. You can recollect your computer architecture concept here, you can easily study. And message processing system, it's a easy one, you can understand. Communication between the processor and memory, that is what this NUMA and then UMA, both you can keep remember. UMA means shared memory, NUMA means distributed memory. when you understand these are the terms, you'll, while evaluating your papers, we'll see that whether you know the basic of VMA and then NMVA. That you have to understand. You quite quickly go through, you have a understand. Emulating message passing and the shared memory system, NB, right? Multiprocessor to shared memory. So send, receive. So totally now next we have to study about the send message and receive message about like this. Synchronous communication, asynchronous communication, we are going to study next year, right? So passing the message, here only we have to going to study about the happened before, right? And casual ordering, like this we have to study. See, the primitives of the distributed communication, primitives of the distributed communications. So last test mean 10 minutes we have to talk about, we have to study about question papers. So we will go through this, I will discuss about what are the other topics available. Keep remember blocking and non-blocking. These two is enough. If you understand this thing, these remaining topics are very easy. I'll tell you something here. Blocking and non-blocking, synchronous, asynchronous, primitives means what? Because specifically here what we are studying, message communications. The communication happening between two systems. So who is sending the message, who is receiving the message between them only is happening. Our blocking mechanism means what? So blocking mechanism means the sender is ready to send a message. That time it is blocking other processor not send the message. That is a blocking mechanism. Same like another end receiving end, while receiving the message, for example M1 message are received by receiver, that time it is stopping other processor to receive the message. So what happened after time? After time only one communication, sender sending the message, receiver is receiving the message, it's happening. That is what blocking mechanism. That is called synchronous communication. That is called synchronous communication. So this is about the synchronous communication. So blocking, non-blocking. Blocking means one is sending the message, that time other processor will be waiting. And receiving end also, while coming the message to this particular processor, it is receiving the message. Same time other processor is waiting. That is blocking mechanism. Non-blocking mechanism means there is no blocking for sender and receiver. One person is sending the message, other processor receiving means, and second processor can receive the message. It's a buffered, buffering means, you know, buffered option. Means the asynchronous means buffered options. It will be stored in the buffer. And then a queue. Queue means what? Right? First in, first out. Like this, it will be taking the messages. So that is happening in the primitive of distributed communication. Keep remember, blocking, non-blocking. Blocking means synchronous. Non-blocking means asynchronous. Non-blocking means there is no blocking. Like anybody want to send a message in the environment, you can send a message. And the other end, the receiver receives the messages. The next message will be sent. Everything is a buffer each other. The sender, I can keep message in the buffer itself. I can send one by one. One is sent, the second one I can send, third one I can send. This is also receiving at the same time. So that is happening in the primitive of distributed communications. So blocking and non-blocking mechanisms, right? We can understand buffered and buffered. Unbuffered, you see this, data gets copied directly from the user buffer onto the networks, unbuffered mechanism. Same thing, what I told you, same thing is available. Synchronous primitive. The sender and the receiver primitive synchronous. Both the handshake each other means communicate. Now the connection is established. The processing for send primitive is complete only after the corresponding receiver. Primitive has also been completed. That is for the synchronous. There's important 2 marks also. Here, important 2 marks, which are the characters of the distributed system. And then you have to study the shared memory interconnection networks, what are there. Distributed memory interconnection network, what are there. Synchronous primitives means what? Asynchronous primitives means what? Happened if it was, means what? Like this, some 2 marks will be coming, right? These are the important one you have to study. And then distributed system and shared memory system, difference they are asked. These are the 2 marks you keep longer, right? And asynchronous primitive, sender's primitive is said to be asynchronous. If the control is returned back to the invoking process after the data item sent to be copied out of the user specified output. So you kept in the buffer and sending the data. It's a non-blocking mechanism. Blocking primitives is blocking if the control returns to the invoking process after the process complete. Right? So non-blocking means there is no blocking. You will send the message and receive the messages. So this is what I have given here. You can quickly go through and study. Right? So totally you've got the fixed base. How many bases you cover? So it's about the blocking and non-blocking mechanisms. Something is explained here. You can go through that easily, you can understand the blocking and non-blocking mechanism. And about the process synchrony. And library and standards. So what are the MBM, message passing interface? And then there are two things that are available. OpenNP and then MBA. These are the things we used in the distributed applications. This is a software. Message passing interface means how there's a process happening synchronously, parallelly. We'll be studying in the 8th semester. 8th semester, we'll be studying multiple architecture concepts. Here, we'll be studying about MBA, message passing interface, that is a programming language. Another one is OpenNP, is another programming language. Both programs are used in the multiprocessor environments, means shared memory architecture, distributed memory architecture. Here they are talking about write libraries only. How MBA, the message passing library program, and what are the libraries are used for remote communication between the server. So we know that distributed architecture, there is a program is there, not C++ Java used here. Here, OpenNP software is there. Another software is the MBA software is there. So like this, MBA means message passing interface. These are the software are used. Synchronous versus asynchronous. So anything you can explain here, like this, even something. When you draw this diagram, it is very good, very easy to get the marks. So this is a processor one, events. These are internal events. And these are the send event. When you look at the diagram inter, then you can easily understand. Like this diagram, you can easily draw. See, processor one is sending the message to processor zero, sending the message to processor one. Right? There is a cut. Right? And then here from there, this M1, and M2 communication here, M3 communication happening. Here M4 communication, here M7 communication. Then P2 is communicating to the P0. It is happening in your system. So processor 1 is sending the message to process 3. So like this happening. So what is event happened before means, see this, the M1 is a event and then M4 is a event. But which event happened before? M1 is happened before. But what is that? M1 less than M4. Why M1 less than M4? Please understand, this is only the concept. You have to remember here. So timestamp, when you calculate the timestamp to happen this event here, that is less than the timestamp, total time calculated here to happen this event here. But this much time is happened to taken, time is taken to happen this event. But here you see this process started immediately, this process, this message passing is done. So that is what the events, next you will be studying casual event or even happened before is one of the key term we are studying here. Which event happened first? Which event happened next? So like this you will be studying here. So this is what. So when you draw this diagram, and you can explain, you can easily explain how time will be calculated, clocks will be used. That's all. This is the basics. You can easily understand here. Understand? Right. So another 10 minutes is here. So this diagram, what I'm talking about, this message passing from one process to another process. This is a event. And how time will be calculated, that is the timestamp will be calculated based on the timestamp only, which even happened before and next. That is what the concept of here. That if you understand, you can easily try to study here. Clock trip. So here you see, based on what happened, this communication, message passing only, process to process. Everything explained, all the messages sent, round are received with the text, same round, like this one. Asynchronous to synchronous system, synchronous to asynchronous system. Some systems following synchronous, some system may be the asynchronous system. How communicating each other? So that is what the given line, given explanation here. So one is asynchronous system, another one is synchronous system. The communication happening between two systems. That is given here. With the diagram, you can easily explain, right? And then design issues and challenges. Design issues. So when you want to design like this distributed system, what challenges are you facing? That is what the issues here. Communication. How to manage at a time multiple communications. How many processes created, naming, synchronization. Synchronization means what? For example, there is a common data, more than one processor is want to access that common data. You might be studying an operating system, right? Deadlock conditions, something is studying, why this thing happening like this? There is a synchronization problem. Everybody want to access the same data. Then you have to allow one processor first and another processor. That is a problem is there here. And status store and access, consistency is a problem, replication is a problem. Fault tolerance, because multiple processors are running, security issues, like this, there are many challenges are there. You can easily go through. And then algorithm challenges, distributed system. Because like this system, what kind of algorithm can be used for solving like this problems? So that is also there. And time, global states and distributed system. Physical time need to be calculated. Each system is having the local time also need to be calculated and that global state, because everything is a communication point of view. E1 and E1 2, E1, E2, T of E1, T of E2, timestamp also you have to calculate. So these things will be discussed here. And physical clock synchronization, leader elections, mutual elections, exclusions. We'll study again the same concept in second unit. Also, we'll study some of the algorithm we'll discuss. Distributed algorithm. There also the same concept will study. That time we can go into the topics. Now I'm telling the basics one. Group communication, multicast, everything. Group communication, multicast, unicast, and all you know. The same message to send to the one of the group, one specialized group. That is multicast. So what for this? How will the communication between happening in the multicast group? That is discussed here. Right? It's a theory. Just go through this one, it's easy to understand. Mutual exclusion. At a time, only one process to be executed. So that is under explained here. So this you can, when you go through this particular content, you can easily understand. And we'll use the next third unit under, we are talking about voting algorithm, quorum system, and there are some of the algorithm, consensus algorithm, well, we'll study again. Why this consensus algorithm? Agreement between two systems. How you are sending me message, how I'm sending to you message. How we are cooperating each other, synchronization. Other than the algorithm rules. Keeping this one, you can easily understand how we are passing the ACID rules, how we are following the ACID rules, everything. A checkpoint for recovery algorithm. Failure happening means how we can recover from rollback, where the failure point, from there we can recover whatever, available. So everything, load balancing, how one server is loaded means data migration, computation migration, it's available in the 15 minutes also you can study. Data again, scheduling, performance, applications of the distributed system, newer challenges, mobile system, its applications, your mobile working in the distributed system, sensor networks working under the distributed system, pervasive computer, big computer is computing, controlling the, for example, in my room, whatever is available through Wi-Fi, whatever I can control. That is a pervasive computing. That is what the environment, processor embedded in the environment and perform computing. That is location-based computing. That is ubiquitous and privacy computing. That is very important, peer-to-peer computing. What you are studying here, peer-to-peer computing, P2P. Computing, representing computing over application layer, because wherein all interaction among the processes are at the peer level. Means everybody is a leader. Peer means leader. Everybody is a leader. You can peer communication, you can service communications. You can respond to the communication. And distributed agents, distributed data memory, basics only. You can go through, if you have doubt, you can understand. Grid computing. Grid computing is there are servers are connected to each other and processing larger tasks. Means huge amount of tasks will be processed here. And distributed system challenges, confidentiality, authentication, availability, and code. The model of distributed systems, computations. Here we are talking about this, communication, message, sending a message from one system to another process. How process one is sending a message to process two. That is what the communication. So internal event, same message. Previously we studied, that event. Casual event, how it is happened. That is what we are studying here. Here only we are talking about event happened before casual order, like this one. See this, event one, event two. So event one of two, happening here, event two of two. So this is phase diagram for distributed executions. And this is a casual order precedence. Relations, which event happened first, which event happened second. This equation you have to go through. Physical concurrency, communication networks. Let's go through problems. It's still like the same thing topic will study in next topic also. The diagram, whatever you want to explain, take diagram and explain. And cuts are also very important topic here. So somewhere see, this is the cuts. So this is the cuts, we'll check whether the consistence is there or inconsistent is there. So that is what we'll check with the cuts of the events happening. In your environment, there are many events that happen. So we'll have the cuts here. Means events are inconsistent happen or inconsistent happening, like this, we'll check. That is what we, that's we can go through this topic, you can easily understand. He said, here also you have to study. And the logical clock. Every event is happening with the time. Time is running bottom. That's why I told you this one. See, so this time stamp is less than this time stamp. So that's why less than this one. So that's a casual precedence. Happened before. I'll only explain this happened before. You can understand from this equation. Logical clocks is very important. Scalar time, vector time. Scalar time means single event. Vector time means more than one array concept. More than one event. You know? Yes. Next one is like this one. So vector time. There are collection of events are available in the vector. But you can go through. That's all. So there are basic properties you can go through even declaring. So finally, you can study about the network protocol, centralized system and distributed system, how network time protocol is working. You can study this. Almost now, 4:30. Okay. So that's all. So this is what we discussed. So just quickly, what we studied here, shared memory architecture, distributed memory architecture, and then we studied about the characteristics of these things, and then we studied what we studied next, right? A network, interconnection networks we discussed, and then we studied about the events we have studied, communication between these networks we studied, and then peer-to-peer networks we studied, client server architecture we studied, open FIFO we studied, and then client taxonomy that we studied. So like this, all the concepts you keep remember. Go through this content, what I have here. I'll share the content also with you. You can go through later. If you have doubt, you can send me a message. I'll clarify the doubts. And finally, the question span you can see quickly here. So this is from your book. The question is very simple only. When you go through this question, you can easily understand. Yes, I'll show you one question. You can see chapter one, access solution, because you're going to write open book test. It is available in the book itself. See, give 5 types of hardware resources and 5 types of data software resources that can be usefully shared. Give the example of their sharing and it comes in distributed system. The questions will be like this only. So far, I give an idea. But you cannot straight away find out the answer. Where is this answer for in your book like this? You cannot underline and you cannot write. This you have to think. So where this content is available, what content need to be written here. Like this, you have to analyze and you can write. That will be the question in your university exam pattern like this only. Someone experienced people going to take questions. Mix of these questions only will take. They will not take only this kind of questions. They will take some of the questions, direct questions, some of the questions. You have to analyze and try. Here, no problem solving and all, but you can analytics you can apply here. Something you have to analyze and you write answer. So, one of the questions I given like this. Give 5 types of hardware resources, CPU, memory, and 5 types of data and software resources that can be usefully be shared. So you know answer, but you have to, when you go through like this answer, you can write web page, file, object, database, like this. And second question you see, a user arrive at the railway station that she has never visited before, carrying a PDA that is capable of wireless networking, suggest how the user would be provided with the information about the local services, amenities at the station. Without entering the station, names and arguments, what technical challenges must be overcome? Over here, this challenge is typical when you are in the place, what will be thinking. You have to relate to your distributed system, whatever you learned the knowledge from there, that you have to apply here. See, user may be able to acquire the address of the locally learned information as automatically as possible. Once method for the local wireless networks are provided the URL web pages about the locality over the local wireless networks. Like this, you have to give an answer. And this answer you cannot find out in the book. Related to topics, you can go and say, take the content and you have to write. So write this only, you have to prepare. So this is also, this things also, I'll share with you. So this content also you have to go through before your exam. It is in your hand only, it's not only, you know, teaching is not, because we'll not teach every topic now. Now the time you have to study. So take like this content and go through that, because you are not mucking anything. You are writing the exam by looking at the content. So content where it is available. What is the knowledge? What is the knowledge you have? Based on that only you can search that for content. At least you have to know where the content is available, what you have to write for the content. That is very important for the open books test. So that's why you have to go through this crowd. Mainly the concepts. So whatever the topic, unit one topics are given, and you can refer the previous university questions also. Based on this, you can go through and you can write. Right? I hope everybody got an idea to write the first unit. Okay, so now the first unit is covered. All the topics I given explanations, you can easily understand. And then whatever now I discuss at last, the questions, whatever the solved questions I shown you, that also you can study for your exams. So I share these materials. You can easily go through and you can easily study. Okay. Thank you.